Hello guys, welcome to my 18 MAT 11 class. The title of 18 MAT 11 is Calculus and Linear Algebra, but I'm going to discuss in my lecture class is module 2. It's nothing but differential calculus 2. My name is Dr. K.M. Rupa. I'm a professor at Department of Mathematics, Bangalore Institute of Technology, Bangalore. Now in the differential calculus 2, it's nothing but it's a continuation of differential calculus 1, but it's not required. What are the things you discuss in the differential calculus 1 means module 1 is not required for to study for differential calculus 2. Now in the differential calculus 2, I'm going to discuss based on our video syllabus. The first topic is nothing but Taylor's and McLaurin series. They're given in the syllabus very clearly. Now we are going to discuss only the statement of Taylor's theorem and McLaurin's theorem. The extension of Taylor's and McLaurin's theorem is nothing but Taylor series and McLaurin series. Why don't you first look into the Taylor's theorem? Now first I'm going to consider the statement of Taylor's theorem and also McLaurin's particular case of Taylor's theorem is nothing but McLaurin's theorem. Before moving to the next step, now the question is arise why you need to study for Taylor's series and McLaurin series. Thus, Taylor's and McLaurin series are very much useful in your engineering course. Whenever I want to find out the value of the limit is involving sine function, cosine function, tan function, means involving any exponential, logarithmic or trigonometric function. Now, in some few cases, it's not possible to find out the value of the limit using any method. In such cases, first we have to expand the given trigonometric function or logarithmic function or exponential function in terms of the series with the help of McLaurin series, and then we have to find out the value of the limit. Then easy to find out the value of the limit instead of to take a original function. Therefore, there in such situation we are going to use McLaurin series. And also, how much accuracy required in the problem? Based on that, sometimes we are going to take for sine function or cosine function, tan function or cot function, etc. Sum of first few terms of the McLaurin series, four terms of the McLaurin series, five terms. How much accuracy required? How we get accuracy to take the and to consider number of terms in the series? We get more accuracy we get. Then you want to learn, there we are going to use McLaurin series. Therefore, overall, we are going for any engineering stream. This McLaurin series and Taylor series are very, very important. What are the two cases? Whenever it's not easy to take a decision for based on a trigonometric, logarithmic or exponential, in such cases, using McLaurin series, we have to expand. After the expansion, it's possible to take a decision. And also, how many terms I'm going to see, some few cases, especially for in our core subject, it's not taking a decision using sin x, cos x. And also in CCP program, if you want to write a CCP program from sin or cos and tan x, etc., you can't write directly for C or C++ program. We first you have to express sin or cosine or exponential or logarithmic in terms of McLaurin series. Once you express that trigonometric function, logarithmic function or exponential function in terms of the series, infinite series, based on that we are going to write a program. Then easy to write a program. Writing a program also, see, still you don't know that step. Once you get into the writing a program from trigonometric function, your concerned teacher is telling that you know what is a sine series, you know what is a cosine series. First you express in series. How we get the series? We get a series from McLaurin's series. McLaurin series is a particular case of Taylor's theorem. Yeah, first you're looking to the statement of the Taylor's theorem. Theorem means is involving finite number of terms. That's all. Now, what is the statement of Taylor's theorem? Now, I put a figure in the where in the each slides is who is invented author. Based on that, I put it the author figure. That's all. Now, Taylor's theorem, the statement is, Taylor's theorem statement, if f of x and its first n minus 1 derivatives, and its first n minus 1 derivative means what actually, f of x, f dash of x, you know what's the meaning of that. F, and its first n derivatives are nothing but f of x, f dash of x, f double dash of up to till n minus 1 derivatives are continuous. But nth derivative continuous in which interval? Closed interval a comma b. What's the meaning of closed interval? Any value belongs to closed interval means at most equal to the upper limit is b, at least equal to the lower limit. X greater than or equal to a, less than or equal to b. Open interval means strictly greater than a, less than b. But the into the nth derivative exists in the interval a comma b. Then there exists at least one point in between a and b, because our nth derivative exists in only open interval. Choose any value in the open interval means it's strictly greater than initial value, less than terminal value. This is a difference between closed and open interval. Whenever I'm taking the interval is in the square bracket, that meaning is closed. Closed means included both initial and terminal values. End values are included. Open interval means you are not included. We are going to exclude it both end points, means initial and terminal points. This is a difference between open and closed interval. Now here, what's the statements to consider here? F of x and its n minus 1 derivatives are continuous in the closed interval a comma b. Fn of x exists in the open interval a comma b. Fn of x exists in an open interval a b means this derivative exists only in the in between a and b. Does not exist at a, does not exist at b. This is the meaning. But the derivative exists up to n minus 1 derivative exists at both the end points, say a and b, what I taken in the problem. This is a meaning. But our nth derivative exists in the between the interval, given interval a and b. We can't say that fn of x is, a is exist, fn of b is exist. Then there exists at least one point. That point must be in where? In the open interval. Why? Because we have taken that point based on what actually? Our nth derivative. Because our nth derivative only exists in each interval, open interval a comma b. There exists at least one point c. C or take any value between your given interval, open interval, such that the result is f of b is nothing but f of a, okay? F of a plus f of b minus a by 1 factor into f dash of a, b minus a whole square by 2 factor into f double dash of a plus etc. plus b minus a to the power of n minus 1 by n minus 1 factorial. If n minus 1 derivative of a, because up to n minus 1 derivatives are, up to n minus 1 derivatives are exist in each interval, closed interval. Therefore, we have taken f dash of a, f double dash of a, up to n minus 1 derivative of a is possible because we have taken the statement up to n minus 1 derivatives are continuous in the closed interval a and b. It's continuous in the closed interval a b means f dash of a exists and f of b, f dash of b also exists. Up to which derivative? N minus 1 derivative. While come to the nth derivative, this is exists in each interval, open interval. Therefore, you can't take fn of a. I have to choose a value. We already chosen one value. C in the interval a comma b, what's the last term? B minus a to the power of n by n factorial into fn of C. We can't take ARB here because nth derivative exists only the open interval a comma b. This is nothing but our Taylor's theorem. This is a statement of Taylor's theorem. Actually, truly speaking, this Taylor's theorem comes to the extension of our first main value theorem. But it's not included in our syllabus. Therefore, I'm not going to discuss. Actually, in the old syllabus, they have first main value and second main value, etc. Taylor's theorem. Keep in mind, Taylor's theorem is nothing but nth mean value theorem. This is another name of the Taylor's theorem is nothing but nth mean value theorem. For example, you have a first derivative. How to find out nth derivative? First, you have to find out first derivative, and then you know how to find out the derivative. Yes. Let's see. For example, I'm showing that how to find out nth derivative of cos x, cos ax. Now, first you find out first derivative. Find out second derivative, find out third derivative. In maybe even in maybe odd, you are writing what is my nth derivative. Like that, what is our nth derivative you are writing? Like that, now based on first and second derivative you are writing, no? Now, like that, here also, Taylor's theorem is nothing but extension of which theorem is first mean value theorem. You have first you have to write the first mean value theorem, second mean value theorem. Extension of that second mean value theorem is nothing but our Taylor's theorem. Therefore, Taylor's theorem is nothing but nth mean value theorem. So you have a nth derivative. Put n is equal to 1, we get a first derivative. Put n is equal to 2, second derivative. Like that. Now, why I'm treating this Taylor's theorem as a nth mean value theorem? Once you put n is equal to 1, that reflects to first mean value theorem. Put n is equal to 2, that reflects to the second mean value theorem. Therefore, this Taylor's theorem is also considered as say, another name is nth mean value theorem. Now, here I discuss the whatever Taylor's theorem based on which interval, based on the interval a comma b. Most of the cases we solve based on this interval, but some few cases we are going to take the interval in another form, say a comma a plus h for h is greater than 0. Why we choose h is greater than 0? Otherwise, there is no meaning. Always upper limit is greater than lower limit. For this purpose, we choose h is greater than 0. Now, same definition, same statement of the Taylor's theorem, but we are considering the interval what actually? A comma a plus h for h greater than 0. If f x and n and its first n minus 1 derivatives are continuous in the closed interval a comma a plus h for h greater than 0, but nth derivative exists in an open interval a comma a plus h, but the small changes here, then there exists at least one point, say theta. Theta we are taken, what's the interval? Not for this interval. We are taken interval 0, 1. When theta lies between 0, 1, definitely a plus theta h definitely lies between a, comma a plus h. That's very easy to prove that. Because observe carefully here. Now we have theta is lies between, theta, theta lies between 0 and 1. Okay, fine. Now, I want to prove that this a plus theta h is lies between what actually? And a plus h. That's very easy. First, you multiplied by a on both sides. 0 less than, first multiplied by h because you already know that h is greater than 0. Once you multiplied by 0, 0 into h is 0, theta h is less than h. Add by a, what we get? A is less than a plus theta h is less than a plus h. Therefore, theta lies between 0 and 1, but I don't want theta lies between 0 and 1. I have to choose any value. That value lies between what's a given interval? A comma a plus h. Now, theta lies between 0 and 1, that implies a plus theta h lies between what? And a plus h. Therefore, then I have to choose one of the values, say theta is between what actually? 0 and 1, then a plus theta h lies between a and a plus h. This is easy to, this is nothing but alternative form of Taylor's theorem. Where we are going to use this alternative form, statement of Taylor's theorem? Whenever you want to find out the value of theta, whenever I have to verify whether the Taylor's theorem is verified or not, using the interval a comma a plus h, it is enough to show that at least one value of theta must be less between 0 and 1. Don't confuse with the statement of the interval a comma b and a comma a plus h. Some few cases we are going to use this result. This is nothing but alternative form of Taylor's theorem. I think it's clear. Now this is a statement of Taylor's theorem. I consider both the interval a comma b and also a comma a plus h. Observe carefully, a comma a plus h means h must be greater than 0. If you want to verify whether the Taylor's theorem is verified or not, it is enough to find out at least one value of theta must be less between 0 and 1. Theta less between 0 and 1, then a plus theta h less between a and a plus h. Now, but always we are not going to use the interval a comma b. We are talking about series. This is theorem what we discussed in the previous slide. Theorem is involving finite number of terms. But series means is involving infinite number of terms. Now, based on the Taylor's theorem, we are going to narrate what is my Taylor series. Now, Taylor series in the interval a comma x. Instead of b, what I take x. Now, in the Taylor's theorem having n number, up to which derivative, nth derivative, as n tends to infinity, now, Taylor's theorem becomes Taylor's series. It is involving infinite number of terms. Keep in mind, in the Taylor's theorem, is having nth derivative of that is involving finite number, countable number of terms. Now, we are going to define the series as n tends to infinity. N tends to infinity means goes on how many terms in the right hand side? Infinite number of terms. Instead of b, what we are going to take? X. Therefore, f of x is equal to f of a plus x minus a by 1 factorial into f dash of a plus x minus a whole square by 2 factorial f double dash of a. Same for Taylor's theorem, but instead of b, what we are going to consider here? X. Series means as n tends to n approaches infinity means this goes how many terms? Infinite number of terms. The corresponding series is called Taylor series. This series is narrated from which theorem? Taylor's theorem. Therefore, corresponding series is nothing but Taylor series. Now, where we'll see what is the application where they're going to use Taylor's theorem. That's the thing I'm discussing where in my slides. This Taylor series is used to create an approximation of what a function look like. Means I told beginning of the class once I start for McLaren's and Taylor series. Now, if you want how much accuracy required based on that, we are going to take first few terms of the Taylor series, first three terms, four terms. That is nothing. But series is used to create an approximation. See, usually, see, basically what you have a function, you can't take addition. What you have original function. There, once you express in terms of the series, after that is possible. Therefore, series is used to create an approximation of what a function look like. See, how is look like sine series? How is look like cosine series? How is look like, if you want to know how is look like means, now first way, how to look like, to know that, there we are going to use Taylor series and express a sine function, cosine function, tan function, cot function. Yeah, see, you can't say for tan x itself how it look like. Once you express in the form of series, using Taylor series, then we get idea how it look like sine function, cosine function, etc. There we are using Taylor series. And also, essential theoretical tool in computer science and approximation. Whenever you want to find out approximate value, essential tool is one of the tool of mathematical tool is nothing but Taylor series. Taylor series is one of the tool in where essential tool is need must in computer science. If you want to avoid the mission error, there we are going to use some cases Taylor series in computer science. And also generally to find out the approximation, accurate approximation, I want to know, you have to use one of the tool is nothing but Taylor series. Now, and also other than that, I written here three important applications of Taylor series. I have so many, but I consider common, essential applications. Using Taylor series to find the sum of a series. Yeah, it's possible to find out sum of a series using what? Taylor series. Using Taylor series to evaluate the limits. I'm showing after this slide how to evaluate the series, okay? Sometimes it's not possible to find out the value of the limit. I told this part. Once you express in the form of series using Taylor series, then it's possible to find out. Using Taylor polynomial, means Taylor series, to approximate the function. For example, in Newton-Raphson method, to find out the roots, some of the cases, we are going to express the given function in terms of the series by using Taylor series. Finding the approximate, I have to convert the approximate function, then I have to find out the root also, we are using our Taylor series, okay. Next, I'm showing one animation here. I'm showing later for this animation, after that, okay. Just observe this. Before going to wind up my PPT presentation, there definitely I'm showing this. Then, next is McLaren series. Observe this. See, McLaren series is nothing but it's a particular case of our Taylor series. Now, once you put A is equal to 0, initial value 0, that reduced to what? McLaren series. That McLaren is invented the series, that series is also called McLaren series. First one, who is invented? Taylor. That's a figure is nothing but Taylor, who is invented author. That is a Taylor, that is nothing but Taylor's theorem, and corresponding series is nothing but Taylor series. Once you give the particular value, see, x is a is equal to 0, then what we get actually, Taylor series is reduces to or give rise to what actually McLaren series. This is the author photo what display in the right corner. Now, what is our Taylor's McLaren series here? F of x is equal to f of 0 plus x by 1 factor into f dash of 0 plus x square by 2 factor into f double dash of 0, etc. This is nothing but is a, you know, agree further, this is a particular case, McLaren series is a particular case of which one? Taylor series. Once you give the A is equal to 0, that reduces to R, that implies McLaren series. Now, after that, I'm going to show you this result. I'm going to discuss later. Now, it's familiar with McLaren series. Okay. Next, I move to the next slide. I told just few minutes before, this Taylor's series is useful. We are going to use to finding the limit also. For example, I told McLaren series is a particular case of Taylor series. Therefore, see, one of the problem I consider here, find the limit as x tends to 0 of x minus nx by x to the power of n, where n is an integer. N is an integer, they are not given, it's a vast value. They are not given, n is up to 10, is equal to 1 to 10, 1 to 20, 1 to 5, like that. They are given n is an integer. Whatever it is, integer means it's a very vast value. It's not easy to evaluate. If you want to evaluate to find out the value of the limit, first you have to know what's the value of n. Without knowing the value of n is an integer, it's possible to find out the value of limit using McLaren series. That's why I told some cases whenever it's not possible to find out the value of the limit, there also we are going to use Taylor series or McLaren series. McLaren series is nothing but a particular case of Taylor series. Now, this is not possible because n is an integer, is a very vast value. What we are going to do? You already know from the McLaren series, we have to expand sin x. We have to write the series of sin x using McLaren series. Once you write the series of sin x, after simplify that, we get numerator in the form of series. Once we get in the form of series, and then I have to divide each and every term divided by x to the power of n. Once you divide that, we get x to the power of 3 minus n by 3 factorial minus x to the power of 5 minus n by 5 factorial, etc. We get this is a form of series we get. Now I'm going to take if n is equal to 3. Once you put n is equal to, if you want to try this, put n is equal to 3 in the, n is an integer, therefore now I'm going to take n is equal to 3. Particularly put n is equal to 3, so now we get the value of the limit is what actually. See, n is equal to 3, observe 3 minus 3, what happened? X to the power of 0, what is x to the power of 0? 1. 1 by 3 factorial, what is 1 by 3 factorial is 1 by 6, as x tends to 0, except this term. In the first term we get 1 by 6, in the rest of the term having x, as x tends to 0, what happened? After the first term, every term is must be 0. What's the limit of x tends to 0 of 1 by 6 is constant only. If n is equal to 3, we get what's the value of the limit is 1 by 6. If n is less than n, if n is less than n, every term is involving x, therefore what happened? That value must be 0. N is less than 3 means is if you want to put 1, 2, whatever the negative value is given integer, and maybe negative integer, maybe positive integer, definitely every term is involving s, as x tends to 0, what happened here? X tends to 0, every term having x, we get 0. N greater than 3, this is divergent. Divergent means the x comes in denominator, then we get 1 by 0 is infinity, is divergent. No, but at least I have to write the value of the limit, no? Without knowing the value of x, without knowing the value of n. Therefore, is it possible if, based on what? McLaren series. Therefore, without using McLaren series, I can't give any conclusion for the given function where n is an integer. This is one of the example what I consider. Means the conclusion is finding and calculating the limit some cases, we are going to use McLaren series. Next thing, now I'm coming back to the McLaren series because I want to show this, how is this animation is look work like, because observe carefully. Yeah, observe this animation. Taylor series enter into, you know that already I explained McLaren series. Observe this. See, for you observe this, changing the value of n, then changing bending of curve for the blue and red line. Observe carefully. I return the explanation for this. See, progression for McLaren series approximation of the exponential function. This is nothing but this what animation I'm showing, that it's a McLaren series expansion function for e power of x based on n values. n based on the value of n. N is equal to 1 means first term. N is equal to 2 means first two terms of the exponential series. Put n is equal to 3 means first three terms of the exponential series. Put n is equal to 3 means first three terms, first four terms like that. See, observe the blue curve indicates the exponential function. That's the original exponential function. Once you plot a graph, this is what is a blue curve is nothing but our exponential function. The red curve indicates the exponential function. Once you expand the series for exponential using Maclaurin series, suppose I have to take first term of the Maclaurin series. This is a curve. They start from n is equal to 1. Observe carefully. They start. See, observe. N is 0, look like n is equal to 1 like that. N is equal to 2, n is equal to 3, n is equal to 4, n is equal to 6. N is equal to 7 is saturated. Please try to understand. Once so saturated, the curve is come out. Please try to understand the meaning of this animation is for how, suppose you consider how many terms of the Maclaurin series, we get actual curve of e power of x. The blue curve is actual curve of e power of x. Then first you write the expansion of e power of x using Maclaurin series. Suppose I have to take n is equal to 0 means, suppose I have to take first term of the exponential series, that is n is equal to 0. N is equal to 0, it is look like our first term. N is equal to 1 means I have to take, please try to understand, n is equal to 0 means we are not considering a term. N is equal to 1, first term. N is equal to 2, up to second term. Sum of two terms of the Maclaurin series. Please try to understand. Put n is equal to 3 means I have to consider first three terms of the Maclaurin series. And then for e power of x, put n is equal to 4, first four terms of the Maclaurin series. Put n is equal to 5 means first five terms of the Maclaurin series. N is equal to 6 means first six terms of the Maclaurin series. And next, once you take first seven terms of the Maclaurin series of e power of x, that converge. Our actual curve. This is blue line is nothing but our actual curve of exponential curve. Suppose I have to take zero term, first term, first two terms, first three terms, first four terms, first five terms, first six terms, first seven terms of exponential series of Maclaurin series that converge what actually our actual curve. Means not necessary to take infinite numbers or number of terms of exponential series. It is enough to take up to how many terms? Up to 7 terms. Once you take up to first 7 terms of the Maclaurin series of e power of x, that merge, that coincides our actual curve of the exponential series. After that, even though we are going to take first 8 terms, that's also coincide. If we want to take, once you converge, no? You take n is equal to 8, n is equal to 9, n is equal to 10, definitely it's no coincide with our actual curve. Means where we get where we'll get accuracy for exponential function means, suppose I'm going to take first 7 terms of the Maclaurin series for e power of x, that give rise the value of our e power of x. It's agree for that? That's the meaning of this animation. Now, I think you get idea where they're going to use Maclaurin series, what's the use of the Maclaurin series and Taylor series. See, not necessary to, see, sometimes it's not easy to take, evaluate exponential function based on that, we can't take a decision in the problem. In such cases, we are going to express in terms of the series by using Maclaurin series. The question is arise, instead of e power of x, suppose I express in terms of the e power of x in terms of the Maclaurin series is involving infinite number of terms. Where they're going to stop? How many terms I'm going to carry? This figure shows I can carry up to how many terms? 7 terms. Suppose I have to take first 7 terms of the exponential series from the Maclaurin series, that give rise our exponential series curve. Because for n is equal to 7, it's coincide with our actual curve of exponential curve. After that, even though I'm going to take n is equal to 8, first 9, 8 terms, first 9 terms, that also converges. Once you converge, the answer must be 0. The answer must be same. What is my error? Error is 0. If we want to have a to find out best approximation, means had to reduce the error. How to reduce the error? Had to know where our actual curve is converge sum of how many terms of the corresponding McLaurin series. This is the actual story of this figure. This is the beauty of your McLaurin series or and also Taylor series. See, why? Because McLaurin series is nothing but particular case of Taylor series. Therefore, that Taylor series involvement also is there. I think is everyone is clear for this animation. From this figure, exponential curve is coincide with sum of 7 terms of the McLaurin series. This is the beauty of McLaurin series. Then first try to take first 7 terms of the McLaurin series of e power of x. Then what you want to proceed, take a decision. We say that confidently this is a more accurate approximate solution of our corresponding problem. I think everyone is clear. What is the thing what I am explaining that. See, once I come out zoom out, it's not working animation. That's why I'll keep this figure last. Now, total conclusion of Taylor's and McLaurin series is it's possible to find out the value of the limit, and also it's possible to find out not necessary to take infinite number of terms to carry for our exponential function, sine function, cosine function. Now, observe where our actual function we get to carry sum of how many terms in the McLaurin series. This is the beauty of our McLaurin and Taylor series. Okay, now this is a thing I'm going to give an idea for this. Thank you very much for listening what I explained for McLaurin and Taylor series and McLaurin and Taylor's theorem. Now overall my conclusion is why you need to study for McLaurin series and Taylor series. What's the use? The conclusion part is whenever it's not possible to take a decision for trigonometric function, logarithmic function and exponential, there we are going to express in terms of the series. Once you express in the form of series, then easy to take a decision. And also in your course subjects, instead of cosx, you can't take a decision. They're going to take some of first two terms of the cosine series, first two terms of sine series. I think now we get the idea. How much accuracy required based on that? They're going to carry number of terms from the McLaurin series for the corresponding function. That's all. See, in your course subject is not required much accuracy. They're going to take instead of cos x, they're going to take approximately x. Instead 1 plus x they're going to take. Sometimes they're going to take approximately 1 also, 1 plus x squared. See, a series of cos x is nothing but 1 plus x squared by 2 factorial like that. Therefore, what were they going to take? Whenever they're going to take, they're not required much accuracy, they're going to take approximately 1. And also another one point I want to explain before I'm going to wind up this class. This is a very, very important thing is, see, in your course subject, if you in the first year itself, sometimes you have cos theta. They're going to expansion of cos theta is 1 minus x squared by 2 factorial plus x to the power of 4 factorial like that they have. Okay. Now similarly theta. Theta squared by 2 factorial, theta to the power of 4 by 4 factorial, etc. Oh, is it clear now? And also sine theta, they're going to take theta minus x theta cube by 3 factorial. Like that. It's okay. Now, see, observe carefully. Now they're going to take, this is an expansion. If you want to, I explain what is my McLaurin series. For example, what is my McLaurin series for that? Just now explained f of 0 plus x by 1 factorial into f dash of 0, x square by 2 factorial into f double dash of 0. If you want to find out on the spot itself, you take f of x is equal to cos x. What is my cos x? Yeah, you neglect this. What is my f of x? This is cos x. What is f of 0? Cos 0, everyone you know 1. What is my f dash of x? Because I want to find out f dash of 0. First you find out f dash of x. What is that? Minus sine x. Okay. That implies what is my f dash of 0? Sine 0 is 0. What is my f double dash of x? What is derivative of sine x? Minus cos x. That's why I written minus x square by theta square by 2 factorial. Okay. Minus f double dash of 0 is nothing but minus 1. This shows that what is my third derivative of x? What is again derivative of cos minus into minus? We get sine x. Okay. What is 0, 0. Next, try to find out what is fourth derivative of x, cos x. This shows that even derivatives are not equal to 0, our derivatives are 0. But even though even derivatives, simultaneously we get plus minus. Once you substitute in the Fourier series expansion, what we get, my f of x is, nothing but actually f of 0 is 1 minus x by 1 factorial, okay, plus x square by, yeah, observe carefully. Yeah, this is x square by 2 factorial. Next is, because first derivative 0, our derivative 0, f dash of 0, f double dash of 0, if I am neglecting f dash and f double dash, what's the next, x to the power of 4 by 4 factorial. Next is minus, alternative we get plus or minus. Similarly, suppose I have to take f of x is sine function, f of x is sine function, find out what is f of 0, what is f of 0, 0. What is derivative of sine x? Cos x. What is cos x value? F dash of 0 is 1. Okay. What is f double dash of x? Minus sine x. That implies, what is my f double dash? See, ulta for cosine function. Our derivatives are not equal to 0. Even derivatives are 0 here. For third derivative of x is nothing but minus cos x. What is minus cos x? What is f double dash of 0 is minus 1. This shows that, suppose you substitute that, what we get, f of x is equal to f of 0 is 0, but f dash of 0 is 1. Therefore, x by 1 factorial minus, minus what do? What we get actually? X cube by, yeah, just a minute. Minus x cube by 3 factorial. Alternative, we get plus or minus. This is nothing but series for cos x. This is nothing but series of sine x. Okay. Now, in your core subject, sometimes, suppose we get cos x, they're going to take approximately equal to first term. What's the first? See, instead of taking, see, x is very, very small. Please try to understand how many terms they're going to carry based on the Maclaurin series depending upon the value of x. For example, theta, cos theta. Suppose theta is very, very, very small, they're going to neglect the higher power assumptions. Theta is very small. Theta square is very, very small. Theta to the power of 4 is very, very small. It approaches to where? 0. We are approximately, we consider as 0. Therefore, cos theta is approximately, we are going to take 1. Similarly, sine theta. Sine theta, suppose theta is very, very small, we are going to take approximately equal to theta. Why? Because what's the first term? Theta by 1 factorial. Theta is very small. Whatever square, cube of the theta is very, very small, is near to 0. We are going to neglect. Therefore, instead of, sometimes it's not possible to evaluate using cos theta, sin theta. Suppose the theta is very, very small. Instead of that, they're going to take 1. Instead of sin theta, they're going to take theta. How are they going to take using this Maclaurin series? They're going to take approximately the value of cos theta. They're not exactly equal. Approximately equal to 1. Approximately equal to 1 and also approximately equal to theta. Now, right now, you are not get that situation. Once you go to the higher level, they're going to take 1 and theta. But they're not going to inform how. How we get from the Maclaurin series. This is a thing we have to know. I think you get idea, guys, where they're going to use, what's they used to study for Maclaurin series. Yeah, thank you very much for listening my talk. And now I'm coming back next class. I'm going to discuss few problems how to solve using Maclaurin and Taylor series. Take care. Bye. See you and take care.